Coaster Youth Girls Softball on RTC TV. This is the second batter of the game for Winning Edge. The first batter grounded to the pitcher. She looked to be out, but the first baseman was off the bag and dropped the ball, so she is safe at first base. Up to bat for Winning Edge is the number two batter, Abby. And she hits a pop fly to third base, and it bounces foul. And batter on first base, Jordan, steals second base on a ball in the dirt. The pitcher for Debruler is Izzy. We have Abby up to bat for Winning Edge and Jordan on second base. Low ball in the dirt gets behind the catcher and Jordan will take third base. As I said before, she was on first base from an error and the batter, Abby, is very patient at the plate, has two balls and one strike. That will be ball four. Abby will head to first base. Winning Edge has runners on the corners. Make that runners at second and third as Abby stole second base on her walk.
It's a heads up play on her part.
Very good play. They can't necessarily throw it to second base if they don't want the runner at third to score. So good job by Abby on stealing second base.
Got a run down.
And she's out at home. And another good heads-up play by Abby. Anytime you have a rundown, if you're the base runner, a base behind the person in a rundown, you always need to get to the base that the rundown player left from.
Yeah, she did a nice job of that. She's on third. Now she's coming home. She's going to score easily on the pass ball.
And that is one run to Winning Edge. A risky play by the number one batter, but I think even though she was out, it was a good play because she was able to get the defense a little mixed up and make the catcher more aware, and then the next pass ball scored her teammate.
Absolutely.
So now the third batter is Bella for Winning Edge. There's no runners on and there's one out. From talking to the umpire before the game, they had said this Winning Edge team is pretty tough. Their pitcher, Alina, is a pretty good pitcher even for a younger league. A nice hit ball by Bella, just foul, but a good shot to left field. And as a pitcher, that definitely makes you tighten up a little bit when you see a batter hit a ball like that.
Yeah, she got around on that really well. She's just a little early.
And if I was a pitcher, I would throw her a changeup if she was ahead that much, but we'll see what this pitcher does. And ground ball foul makes the count full to number three batter for Winning Edge, Bella.
Now talk to me a little bit, Abby. At this age level, are they able to throw a nice changeup?
I think the more advanced pitchers, if you have a faster fastball, it makes your changeup more effective. But if you already have a slow pitch, it may not be worth it to throw an even slower pitch if you can't throw it for a strike. So you'll know when you see a pretty advanced pitcher at this level if she can throw a fastball and a changeup.
Gotcha. Well, it looks like she tried the changeup. Didn't work. We've got a runner on first now on the walk.
And one out, and your number four batter and pitcher, Alina, up to bat, and she hits a rocket to left field.
That's a good poke down the left side.
Over the left fielder's head. Her teammate will round third and looks to score easily, and Alina will easily have a stand-up triple. She tries for home.
Going for home.
The throw is
all the way
high.
In.
Very nice hit, and a high throw allows Alina to get an in-the-park home run and score her teammate who was on first base.
Well, that's the first one of those we've seen this year. Heads-up base running. She didn't stop. She had it in front of her the whole time and then went for home easily.
And I think we knew that the infield and the outfield was in trouble once we saw the back of the left fielder.
Absolutely. Pass ball there. Runner's advancing at least to second. She's going to go for third. Winning Edge coming out hungry here in the first inning.
And easily makes it to third. A throw a little high to the first baseman gets away from her, and the fifth batter for Winning Edge, Riley, will get a triple on an infield hit. Now up to bat, we have Deanna, and teammate Riley is on third, while Abby, Bella, and Alina have all scored. So 3-1 with one out early in the first inning. An outside pitch, and it seems like the runners on third base are playing with the catcher, trying to get in rundowns, and that's the second time they have gotten out on a rundown, but definitely very aggressive and not being passive in this game right now.
Absolutely. They're keeping keeping Debruler on their feet, on their toes, I should say.
Making sure that they're aware, and if they fall asleep for a second, they're going to take the next base.
Absolutely.
So this is Deanna up to bat for Winning Edge. She has two balls and one strike. Make that ball number three. So ahead in the count like that, unless it's a perfect pitch, I would not be swinging. And a pretty perfect pitch, and she wanted it, pulled the bat back, now makes it full count. So the score is 3-0, no runners on. Winning Edge, top of the first inning. The count is full, and Deanna has two outs.
Another perfect pitch down the middle.
Make that strike three, and great job to the Debruler pitcher. Struggled a little in the inning. Her defense threw the ball around, but striking out the batter is all that she can handle. So great job. That will be the top of the first inning. We will head to the bottom of the first inning when we are back. You've been watching Rochester Youth Girls Softball on RTC TV. Welcome back to Rochester Youth Girls Softball on RTC TV. We are back in the bottom of the first inning. Abby Malko, and with me today, Scott Sager. We are watching the Winning Edge pitcher warm up, and looks like she's got a pretty tough fastball as we're watching her warm up. And that makes strike one. So, Scott, comparing the pitchers and just watching her from warm ups, what do you think?
Oh, that's control right there. First pitch out of the gate. She's ready to go.
I agree with you, especially at this age when you've got a pitcher who can throw a fastball. That's really all you need if you can mix in a little changeup or an off-speed pitch. But sometimes you can blow it past the girls, and the other teams really don't have much to give back for that.
Yeah, it's a step above right here, and the other kids are trying to keep up, or the other girls are trying to keep up.
And there's the changeup right there. She has a back-spinning changeup, so where some pitchers will hold their index finger tight against the ball, she lets the ball go on her underside and she'll flip her wrist up. So that way her arm speed does not change, but her release point changes, so it's more confusing for the batter. And speaking of that, that is strike three. The first batter for Debruler, Cheyenne, strikes out.
Abby, when we talk about the fastball at this level, what are we talking?
As far as speed?
Yeah.
I would say it depends on the pitcher, and I mean, size at this age is huge. If you've got a girl who's grown early and she's a lot taller than the rest, I mean, height and length for pitching, as we know, is huge. But I would say anywhere from 45 to 50 miles an hour.
Nice. And how far away from plate to mound?
And we are 43 feet away.
Wow.
And when I was early in high school, my freshman, sophomore year, we used to be 40 feet away. And then the entire softball changed the rules and moved it back 3 feet to make the game less of a pitching game and more of an offensive game.
Gotcha.
So if you watch on TV and some of the Alabama pitchers and the girls from Arizona, and they're throwing 68 miles an hour from 43 feet, think about how that was 40 feet away. I know 3 feet doesn't sound like a lot, but when it comes to a game of inches, it's a ton.
Yeah. Another good, that was a riser right there. Is that what you would call that?
Yep, that was a young rise ball. Doesn't break a lot, but just enough for these batters. They haven't seen enough, so it works for them. So second strikeout of the inning, and there have been no runners on. This brings up third batter for Debruler, Daphne.
Yeah, we're seeing some great stuff out of this pitcher so far. Debruler trying to get a bat on her.
And yes, very, very impressive. And you watch a girl like this and you come to a game and you think, man, I hope she goes to Rochester High School because she will be a very good pitcher for us one day.
Absolutely. Let's hope she stays healthy. Now, it looks like she's got the fastball down, got the riser down. That changeup, though, I'd like to see that a little bit more.
I think so. And honestly, I, as a pitcher a little bit back in the day, I would throw changeups, but I would have a curveball and a rise ball, and you know, you'd think that the change of speed pitch would be the easiest to throw, but honestly, it's the hardest because as long as you get your wrist flip, you have the same motion of a fastball as you do a rise ball and a changeup. You just have to flip your wrist in different positions. But when it comes to slowing the ball down by 10 mile an hour, you definitely don't want to miss that pitch because if you miss high, that's sometimes you're asking for a home run. So the changeup, as dangerous as it is, it can be dangerous to a pitcher if they don't put it in the right spot.
She strikes out the sides there. Debruler struggling to get a bat on her. That's got to be tough to see if you haven't seen that all season.
Especially that's the numbers 1, 2, 3 batters, top of your lineup, supposed to be the best. So we'll see how the middle to bottom handles them the next inning. As for now, we'll be heading to the top of the second inning. Winning Edge will be grabbing their bats. You're watching Rochester Youth Girls Softball on RTC TV. Welcome back to Rochester Youth Girls Softball. Abby Malko with Scott Sager on RTC TV. We are back. This is the top of the second inning, and we've got Madison up to bat for Winning Edge, and we have a pitching change for Debruler. Cheyenne is now on the mound, and I'm assuming a pitching change. The first pitcher had a little trouble finding the strike zone, and her defense wasn't as helpful as it could have been.
Ball gets away. Runner's going to make it to second, going to stop at second. Now she's looking. Now she's on her way to third. No play at third base. She's standing up.
And you know when you advance a base and you don't even have to slide to get to that base that you made the right play. I'm not saying that a slide is necessarily a bad thing, but you know you've got plenty of time when you can stand up on the base that you're headed to. So that will be an infield triple for Madison, and this brings up Gracie to the plate.
Now that last hit, that looked more like a slap.
I was actually looking down at the book, but if she was on the right-hand side, it might have just been her lunging at the ball.
Gotcha.
Because most times, actually 99.9% of the time, slappers will be on the left-hand side. Now, there is a thing that we do down at college, and we call it bunting for a hit. And so instead of squaring to bunt, we'll actually take a step back in the box and we'll run at the pitcher and bunt it at the same time. So it's similar to a slap, but we call it bunting for a hit, whereas most of the lefties that are slapping, they'll be full
ball
sprinting.
Gets away. We're going to have a play at the plate. Sorry to interrupt, Abby.
Nope.
Runner advances and scores.
That will be Madison scoring for a Winning Edge. And another passed ball. I think that's the second run that has scored on a passed ball. And the last inning, we had a run on a passed ball scored and two runs scored by Alina's in the park home run. And big swing and a miss.
That was a good explanation of the slapper, Abby. Talk to me a little bit about some of the bats we're using these days.
Well, if you look at the girls now, and if you can listen while when the bat hits the ball, it's making a high-pitched tinging noise. That means that they're using aluminum bats at this age level, which very nice pitch by the Debruler pitcher there. So they're using aluminum bats. In high school and in college, aluminum bats are illegal, and especially in baseball, those have been illegal for a long time. But to replace the aluminum bats, we now have bats that are composite, so they're kind of made of a plasticky, a hard surface, because the aluminum, the ball bounces off so hard from the aluminum bats, high schoolers were strong enough and big enough that they would actually hurt people from the ball coming off the bat. So now we have these bats called composite bats, and there's certain tricks to them, and they take so long to get broken in as a bat, and they have to be at the college level. When we're at Indiana State, before every conference game, they have to be tested, because if they've been hit so hard, they can be so pressurized that they can become illegal. So it's a fine line between the composite bats, because yes, they're safer, but if they've been used to a certain point, they can be illegal.
Gotcha. Well, we got a safe runner at second base after the steal.
And that is Gracie, who walked to first base and stole second base standing up. We now have Alyssa up to bat for Winning Edge. She squares for the bunt, and she pulls back on what she thought was a ball, and she was correct. And it's always nice if you're on second base like Gracie is right now to look for catcher's signals. Sometimes at this age, they're not very protective of their signals. So if you see the catcher flash a 3-2 and she throws an outside fastball, then you can assume that mostly traditionally the position is second and the pitch is first. So sometimes girls like to pick signals off of second base. Catchers have to be aware of that. And that is strike 3. Alyssa has struck out for the first out of the inning for Winning Edge. This brings up the last batter, Ariana, teammate Gracie on second base in scoring position.
Well, it looks like the Debruler pitcher is settling down a little bit. Let's see what she's got the rest of this inning.
And good bunt, very good bunt. If you look at that placement, can't really place anything better than that. And the missed ball at first base will send Gracie to third, and Ariana will safely be at first base. So if you saw
Ariana going to second.
And good heads-up play. Like we said before, when you've got a runner on third base, it's a very risky play to throw it to second and try and tag her out without letting the runner at third score. So very heads-up play by the Winning Edge runners. They're very aggressive.
Absolutely. The coaches really have them prepared. Not as much time with them as you want before the season starts, but it looks like he's got a good group of girls and well prepared for today, especially on the base running.
And as Ariana laid the bunt down, that was very good. If you could see that, very good backspin. And that's what you want as a bunter. So you can bunt it far out, and if the backspin's on it, it dies right where it's standing, and that's tough for a defender. So now we have leadoff batter and left-hander Jordan up to bat. And she hasn't been slapping so far. She's been keeping her feet still. But since she is a lefty, nowadays you almost assume every lefty is a slapper. And even if, you know, even if they are on the left side and they don't look like huge power hitters, they have so much benefit being on the left side. Even though it's 2 and 3 steps, I mean, like we said before, in a game of inches, a couple feet and a couple steps can make you safe versus out multiple times.
Absolutely.
So good eye on Jordan, the leadoff batter for Winning Edge. Her count is 3-1. She's got two runners in scoring position, Ariana and Gracie. A base hit will score both of them to put this game pretty far out of reach. And that's a ball 4. So we now have the bases loaded with number 2 batter, Abby, up to bat.
Good opportunity here for Winning Edge. DeBruler needs to dig deep. Need some fundamentals and some good baseball here, softball here.
And it's crazy to think, you know, I've been in this position where I am the batter, and I think, you know, so many things can go wrong. If I hit it, they can get a double play, and the inning's over. You know, that's what you think when you're on the side of the offense. But if you're on the defense, all you're thinking is, oh, man, all these holes that they can hit. They could hit a grand slam. They could hit a base hit and score them all. So it's funny how when you're on both ends, you think of a worst-case scenario, and both sides are hoping that the worst doesn't happen.
There it is. Let's see what happens here. Got a tag. All right, a good tag on the runner.
And good RBI by Gracie. Abby might be a little upset that she got one of her teammates out, but I say I would take an out for an RBI any day. So we now have 2 outs. Jordan on second base, Abby on first base, and number 3 batter, Bella, at the plate. Good job by the catcher to throw ahead of the runner in case she decided to steal. Now, that can be a good play if you're consistent, but you definitely don't want to waste a throw and let them advance on an error.
Yeah, absolutely.
But always, the rule of thumb is always throw ahead the runner. So when the girl at second base takes a big leadoff as a catcher, you never want to throw behind her at second base because there's no point. You know, if you throw it to second base, they're going to take off to third. So always throw ahead and make sure they stay behind.
It was a good swing. It was also a nice cut on that. Good pitch, good swing.
The count is 2-1 with 2 outs, 2 runners on base for Winning Edge, Bella at the plate. And good. The Winning Edge catcher, excuse me, the Debruler catcher must have been talked to back in the dugout because she's very proactive at getting her throws down to third, not letting anyone steal on her.
Another good cut, fouled off to the right side. It's going to send the runners back. Give us a full count here with 2 outs in the second inning.
And as a runner, stealing third base is the hardest thing to do on the base paths because it is such a short throw for the catcher. So it would be a risky play unless you've got tremendous wheels. And good eye by the batter. There was really no need to throw to third base since it was a walk, but I guess you'd rather be safe than sorry. So we've got Jordan on third, Abby on second, Bella on first base, and Unfortunately for Debruler, the number four hitter who had an in the parker last inning. If she hits one again, that would be a grand slam. So you can't necessarily intentionally walk the batter, but I have seen it done. I have seen it done where they intentionally walk a hitter to walk in a run because they'd rather have one run than four runs score.
I think it's important to address as well, Abby, as we have ball one outside there, that, you know, at this age, it's all about the experience. The more you see, the more you do, the better you're going to be when it matters at that high school or maybe even that collegiate level.
Yep, I absolutely agree with you. And nice hit. That is fair down the line, and that's a dangerous hit for Debruler because it was just a couple inches fair into the left field corner. That's hard to reach. Elena will be sliding into third. Excuse me, she passes third and
play
has another in-the-park home run.
And that'll be the grand slam. She needs a triple.
So that she is well on her way to hitting for the cycle if she keeps this up. And like I said, this now brings Riley up to the plate, which as the follow-up batter, you got to think, oh. I think Debruler went off the field thinking that it was a run rule, but it's only 9-0. The run rule is 10-0. Like I was saying before, as the batter behind a home run hitter, I've been that person before where you're a younger girl and someone just clears the bases and cranks a home run. You can't be aggressive. You can't try and do the same thing. It's most impressive to me if I see someone get a home run and the follow-up batter gets a hit. That's more demoralizing to a pitcher than someone who goes up swinging and strikes out because you're only helping the other team.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and Debruler doing a lot of things right here, too. They
yes.
need to remember that.
And just some great – I mean, this whole game's come down to really two great hits. And that hit, that was just – that's so hard to defend. You look at it, and it's close to the line. But once it hits the line and goes into the corner, those corner hits, whether it's left field or right field, are so hard to defend. You just got to hope you've got a fast outfielder to get the ball in quickly.
Absolutely. At this age, you know, the leg speed and the arm strength – that's just a dangerous place to be.
Well, and as we talked about experience before, usually the younger players are in the outfield because there seems to be less action and it's more for them to learn. So when you do have your younger players in the outfield, it's harder because they haven't been there as often.
Yeah.
So great play by the left fielder right there as that ball was hit close to the line. And I think they called it foul, but she got right in front of it in a fielder's position. So great job by the left fielder.
I think the umpire did call it fair, and I think he's going to send the batter back to first base.
Oh, and if she throws it, that will be an out.
And
so
she's out. There was confusion on that by the base runner. I'm sure coach will sit down and talk to him about it.
And that will end the inning for Winning Edge after two runs by the first two batters and a grand slam. That makes the score 9-0. We will head to the bottom of the second inning. You've been watching Rochester Youth Girls Softball. Scott Sager with me today. I'm Abby Malco. You're watching RTC TV. Welcome back to Rochester Youth Girls Softball. This is the bottom of the second inning. Abby Malco here with Scott Sager. And Debruler is at the plate while Winning Edge is in the field for their second time this game. Number 8, Taylor, is up to bat for Debruler. She's the number 4 hitter.
I think you're going to see a more aggressive Debruler coming out this inning. They're going to have the bats going. They're going to try and make up this deficit. Again, a couple of big hits really changed the game here. We'll see if Debruler can settle down and get some hits this inning.
And a little confusion in the last inning with that foul ball and Debruler running off almost as if it was a run rule, but they have to play at least three
innings. Called foul ball there.
They have to play at least three innings for a run rule here. And like we said, you know, a couple big hits has put Winning Edge up by a lot, but get a couple base runners and a key hit and Debruler can be back in it before they know it.
Nice pitch there, little inside.
And that's a drop third strike,
yep.
Throwing to first base.
Just like they practice it, huh?
And I think the field umpire called her safe, and the home umpire called her out. But the verdict is that the batter is out. So I think the home plate umpire had a better angle.
Yeah, he overruled there. He could see the tag being administered, whereas the back was to the umpire in the other position out on the field. So an overruling there. We've got one out now in the bottom of the second inning.
Then this brings number six, Katie, up to bat. So one out for Winning Edge. No runners on so far. And one strike on the batter. And as a batter, when you're facing a pitcher that throws pretty hard, you definitely, once you get a couple foul balls, it's just a timing factor. So the fact that she hit the foul ball is definitely good news, and she knows she's close. And there's a changeup that you wanted to see.
There it is. It looks like she got that. That came in right at the plate, though, not quite deep enough.
And it depends on your philosophy and what pitching coach you talk to, but some pitching coaches, when you throw hard enough, they like to see it bounce on the plate. They would rather you make someone chase the ball than have it knee high. And there's the second changeup in a row. They would rather it be too low than knee high for someone to take that ball deep.
Yeah, and with maybe some more inexperienced players, the changeup's not going to work as well because they can lay off of it.
Right.
But a nice fastball there. That's going to be three strikes.
And great job. I'm very, very impressed with this pitcher right now, especially throwing two changeups in a row. Sometimes, you know, batters see one changeup and then, whew, it's all over. But she comes with two changeups in a row and brings a heater down the middle as a batter. That's really hard. That's really hard to defend as far as, you know, when you're on offense, you should never think you're on defense. But sometimes when you got a pitcher this aggressive, you become the defender, and that's never a good thing.
Yeah. Now, we've been talking pitchers, haven't talked much about the catcher here. Seems very experienced, gets the ball back very quickly, can handle the high and tight.
Yes.
How important is that to a pitcher to have someone at this age that they're consistent and has that kind of experience?
Well, so very important. I mean, the catcher always, and it's like the inside joke, or, you know, everyone knows that the catcher does all the dirty work and doesn't get the glory. So at the college level, we like to refer to pitchers as princesses because they have a big crowning circle around them, and they think they own the world. That's just how pitchers go. But you've got a catcher behind the plate who's sweaty, gets hit with foul balls, gets hit with the balls that you're throwing at them, and they can make the pitches, or they can't. When it comes to framing and when you're at the collegiate level, you know, there could be a pitch an inch off, but if you've got a catcher that can frame it, that's huge because you don't have to throw the ball on the plate to make it a strike. Your catcher can make it a strike for you. So a catcher, especially at this age, who can handle a pitcher with this velocity and this power, I mean, think about how effective this pitcher would be if the catcher didn't catch anybody. You know,
yeah.
If all the pitches were flying around, then none of them would look like strikes. So kudos to the pitcher and the catcher for the Winning Edge team. I'm impressed with both of them.
Absolutely. Now, we did have some patience there by Debruler. They were able to watch that pass ball with full count and two outs here in the bottom of the second. Runner on second now. Number nine up to bat.
And this is Olivia up to bat. This will be her first at bat of the game. And her teammate Alexis did steal second base on the pass ball. So just a base hit here for Debruler will put them on the board. And this is the second walk in a row. We haven't seen a walk all game long. As a matter of fact, the first inning was three up, three down in strikeouts, and we have one strikeout this inning, one ground out, and two walks in a row right here. So we will see what the third batter can do.
Good strike down the middle there. Got a smaller batter here too, yet she framed that perfectly.
Yes. And crazy enough, size does matter when it comes to strike zone, because obviously, you know, your strike zone is from the person's supposed to be knees to their shoulder. So if you got a little peewee up there, she can be harder to throw to.
Yeah, there's a change up a little deep with this one. Was that have a little different spin on it?
She let go a little too late. Instead of letting go at her hip, it was a couple inches ahead and just made it a little high.
Strike three right there down the middle. That's going to take us out of the inning. You're watching Rochester Youth League Softball. I'm Scott Sager with Abby Malko. We'll be back with the top of the third inning.
Welcome back to Rochester Youth League Softball on RTC TV. Abby Malko with me tonight is Scott Sager. And up to bat for Winning Edge is the only batter who did not get a bat last inning, Deanna.
Yeah, it was a big inning for him last time.
They almost hit all the way through. So this will be Deanna's second at bat, but after her, everybody will be starting close to their third at bat of the game. And you know things are going well for the team if you get a bat almost once an inning. Count is 2-1 on Deanna. Same pitcher from the second inning, Cheyenne, for Debruler. She did well last inning.
Yeah, I was impressed with Debruler. I know they didn't get any runs on the board, but they came out aggressive with the bats last time. Let's see how they can play some defense this time.
I agree.
It's a good eye there.
Ball
good
four.
Good way to start.
And a very important, no matter what age and what league you're in, the leadoff batter getting on consistently, no matter what part of the lineup you're at, is very important. It's when you're in the dugout and your first batter gets out, you start the inning off with one out, and it's demoralizing, and you just feel like you got no momentum. But once your leadoff batter's on, you feel like you're ready to roll.
Yeah, absolutely. You got it, top of your order here. You've got runner on first, ready to go.
This brings Madison up to the plate, and she will watch ball two bounce in the dirt. And Deanna not going anywhere, although on first base. And I'm surprised at the lack of bunting at this level, because it seems the older you get, it's almost inevitable that you're going to bunt when there's a runner on first base. It actually is a rule at Indiana State that if there's a runner on first base and there are no outs, you must bunt, no matter who you are or what you're doing. And I know in high school, especially Rochester High School, plays a lot of small ball because it's hard to score from first base. If she gets a shot in the gap and it only moves the runner on first base to third base, it doesn't help as much as if she bunted her over to second base.
Yeah, I want to revisit that here in a few moments. You said something there, small ball. We got strike two on the batter there. Full count here, top of the third. Talk to us a little bit about small ball, Abby, and a lot of strategy here in softball.
Yeah, I guess it's kind of how you grow up and who you play with and under what coaches, because there's some coaches who, they want to recruit the biggest, baddest, hard-hitting softball players, but then there's other coaches who all they want is lefty slappers who can bunt and who can run it out. So I think it's whatever you think fits your team best. But I know bunting for all kinds of teams is very important just to move the runner. If your team can't bunt and they can't suicide squeeze a runner home, or they can't move batters, because there are some days where as an offense you just cannot get a hit. No matter what you're doing, the pitcher might just be overpowering, and if you can't get a hit, you've got to find a way to get hit as a batter and then bunt people around. So it's kind of the out once the offense isn't working for the day.
Well, speaking of hits, there's one right up the middle. It's going to advance all the runners. We're going to have bases loaded for Winning Edge with no outs here in the third.
And I don't think hits is a problem for Winning Edge, which might consider their lack of bunting since they've been pretty hot at the plate today. And like you said, now we have Deanna on third base, Madison on second, Gracie on first, and Alyssa will be up at the plate. So good chance for Alyssa to score some runs for Winning Edge. And great pitch to do it. Watched a very nice strike go by. But some hitters like to hit with one pitch. I know a couple girls that I play with, they like having a strike. They like the pressure factor that the next one that comes in, they know they've got to smoke it. And there are others who like to be aggressive, and the first one they see, they like to go after it. So it depends on the batter and how they like to hit.
Well, she got that one again and took a cut, missed. That's two strikes, no balls here.
And that's my philosophy. I don't like hitting with the strike because if for some reason, the pitcher pitches a great pitch and it's a foul ball, now I'm down in the count 0-2. And that's an uncomfortable position if you've got a killer pitcher, because they own you at that point. They can throw a movement ball that's off the plate, and sometimes the umpire will give it to them, two balls off the plate. So that's a dangerous spot to be in sometimes.
Another nice cut, but a good pitch. That's going to take her down for the first out of the inning.
And this brings Ariana up to the plate. She walked last inning and stole second base. So she's got some wheels, and she's got bases loaded. See if she can get a couple RBIs for herself.
Got a good stance there, ready to take a nice cut.
Very good stance, I agree.
Again, let that first pitch go by. I wonder if Winning Edge is coaching the girls that way a little bit.
Yes, I do agree. Sometimes if we have if you face an inconsistent pitcher or someone who can't seem to find the strike zone, you like to take a pitch and see if it's a ball, because you definitely don't want to help them out by swinging at a ball. Which, nice hit, foul.
A good cut down the left side, a little early on that.
And I'm sure all the Debruler fans and players just took a big sigh of relief, because that was a big cut that you didn't want to see rolling in the corner.
Yeah. No, Debruler got a little lucky with that one. Let's see what she does with this next pitch. Got two strikes on her.
And now as a pitcher, you are way ahead of the batter. She's got no balls, two strikes, and you can kind of do what you want because she's got to defend the plate.
Absolutely. Comes right at her with a nice pitch down the middle. Dropped.
And now I wonder how that will be called. It might have been deep enough in the infield, but it could have been an infield fly where the batter was out and whoever was tagged out. But that rule's always been kind of confusing to me, and it must have been deep enough in the infield where they didn't have to call it. So that is the second out, but that will score Deanna from third base. So although one out, counted as a sack fly. And now we have leadoff batter Jordan to the plate. This is her third at-bat in three innings.
Ball outside there on the left-handed batter. Looks back the runner at third.
So Gracie will advance to third, and Great Madison is at third, Gracie is at second, and Ariana is at first. And pass ball will shift all
pass
the runners,
ball.
Run one base, and she will be running into home without sliding as we get a face full of dirt here. And that's a little bit confusing to me as far as her running in standing up. When I was in 12 and under softball, I ran home and stood up and didn't slide, and there was a play at home, and I actually got ejected for it. So I think it depends on the umpire, but I think for the safety of the pitcher or the catcher, whoever is defending home plate, the safest way is to slide, and sometimes you can get ejected if you don't. I ended up learning that one the hard way.
Absolutely, and you know, these are important lessons these girls need to learn at this age so that they can avoid some injury later.
Yes, I agree. Because now, you know, you see them go in there and they're not going too hard, but when you get up to a higher level, some people run in on purpose and try to take people out, so that's later on. They don't seem to be that aggressive yet.
Yeah. Nice cut there. That's going to trail out of play down the third base side.
And long foul ball. And that one's a foul ball where you don't necessarily lose your breath, but you know that the batter is capable of hitting the ball pretty hard and pretty far.
Masham, how many outs? Thank you.
Do it again.
And this brings up Abby to the plate. And that's another long foul ball. Puts the batter down 0-2 in the count. So we have one out. The count's 0-2. And the bases are still loaded for Winning Edge. Number two hitter, Abby, at the plate.
Oh, that one got away from her a little bit. Went behind the batter.
And sometimes with plays like that, you know, if you've got a lefty usually, because right-hander pitchers usually tend to throw toward the left side if they miss, they will sometimes get their bat hit, which counts as a foul ball, which definitely is not a good call that you want to hear as a batter. If you're going to hit a foul ball, you might as well rip it down the line.
Exactly. Well, that one there was outside. It's It's going to be two balls, two strikes, one out here in the third inning. Winning Edge with a big lead over Debrulers.
And that's a nice high fly ball. That will be foul. Just about caught by the left fielder.
Yeah, some communication errors there. I'm seeing some fundamentals that need practiced on a little bit more with Debruler here a little communication right there.
And communication's huge, whether you're playing T-ball or whether you're playing for the national championship in college.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, got her to chase that one clear out. That's going to be the second out of the inning right there. Clear the count. No balls, no strikes. The new batter comes up.
Number three batter, Bella, is up to bat. But speaking of communication, like you said before, not only is it important to catch a ball, but it's extremely important when it comes to injuries. We were down at IU last fall, and the shortstop and left fielder went for a shallow fly ball in left field and took each other out, and one of them hit their face, and one of them busted their knee open, and it was just a big mess, all because no one called the ball.
Absolutely. And that's at the college level where they should have definitely known better.
Exactly my point.
But so we see those plays. We see them all the time. They make good blooper reels as long as everyone's safe.
Right.
But communication, definitely a key to this ball game.
When it comes to the coach, they don't really like the blooper reel plays.
Ball two.
And last batter must have thought the ball was slow enough and high enough that wanted to take a whack at it and just missed it. So we'll see how this batter follows with two balls and one strike, two outs, and bases loaded.
Nice pitch right up the middle, back to the pitcher. It's in the hole as the shortstop was going to cover second, takes it home. Runner safe. We've got runners at first and second with two runners scoring there.
And so that will put Bella on first base. And Jordan will stay at second base.
It was a nice hard shot right at the pitcher. Unfortunately, the shortstop had already moved towards second base, wasn't able to recover the ball and get it over to first. So bases loaded becomes two runners on now, two runs scored, and a big hitter at the plate.
And this is Alina, and she has had two in the park home runs in her two at-bats.
Nice cut there.
And she will run that out, score RBI, and the ball has gone out of play. So the runner on third base, I'm not sure if they advance. I think they stay at their bases. I think they have to be at the halfway point when the ball goes out of play in order for them to advance.
Not sure what the umpire is doing here. Remaking the box. It's awfully dusty out here, windy on this warm summer evening, and so I couldn't even see where the box was. Okay, so both the runners stayed where they were. We've got two outs, score 13 for Winning Edge. Debruler's still trying to pull something together here. Pitcher's just hoping to get out of the inning at this point, Abby.
And until that last at bat, they had done a pretty decent job. They had the bases loaded for quite a few batters and were able to keep them scoreless. But like we said, you know, if you keep the bases loaded long enough, then, you know, you're bound to get a timely hit sometime to clear them off.
Absolutely. And I am impressed with the catcher. She's become much more aggressive for Debruler, keeping those runners tight on third base.
I agree. A nice hit down the line, just foul again. If we could count the amount of foul balls that were close enough to be hits, we'd have a lot of fingers to count on this game.
Just a little early on a lot of them here, but that's good. That means they're getting around on the ball.
Very good, yes. And you can tell a true athlete in any sport by the adjustments they make throughout the game. So, you know, softball and baseball seem to be easily identifiable as far as the adjustments they make. But any sport, basketball, football, anything you play, you've got to be able to make adjustments through the game because the competition is changing as well. So the best athletes and the best players seem to make adjustments the quickest.
Yep. Adaptation is key.
Exactly. And this is Riley up to bat, and she will walk, and her teammate, Bella, will score sliding, and that will move Alina to third base, and heads up base running by Riley, she will move over to second.
Yeah, it looked like that one got away from her, didn't really even come over the plate. As it Got away from the catcher. That makes one more run for the winning edge here.
So with Alina on third base, Riley on second, first base is open, and Deanna, who started off this inning, is now up to bat again.
Wow. And all four runs have been scored with two outs,
yes,
if I'm not mistaken.
You are correct.
Pitcher staying in there, settles in for a nice strike down the middle.
And that's a great job. You know that the pitcher's mentally in this when things aren't going her way, but she can start off with the first pitch strike.
Absolutely. Not a bad pitch there. We might get a run down here. She's not afraid to throw it. Runner does get back. We got one ball, one strike, two outs here in the third inning. Number seven up to bat. Who's that, Abby?
Number seven is Deanna. She started off the inning, and she walked and made her way around the bases and scored. And great job by the catcher. The ball was high and went backwards. Alina tried to score on that play, but the catcher was not having it. Turned back around, charged right away, and made a throw.
Little cat and mouse over there on third base. At least they're still having fun. And you know, when it boils down to it, that's what it's all about here at Rochester Youth League Softball.
Exactly, and that's what Todd Beeler was with me at the baseball game last weekend, and we were just talking about that. You know, you can have as much competition as you want, and there's rivalries, and there's, you know, competition within your friends on the other team, but if you're not enjoying what you do and you're not having fun, no matter what level you are, I don't care if you're playing t-ball or if you're playing men's slow pitch later on, if you're not enjoying what you do, then you shouldn't be out here.
Absolutely, and they are having fun. The girls still in great spirits here. Pitcher still struggling a little bit. That's her her fourth walk?
Yes, I think so. And that's actually Deanna's second walk of the inning. So that will put her on first base and brings Madison up to the plate. And like you said, we've had two outs for quite some time. I'm sure the pitcher's just hoping to get the defense one out so they can head back to the dugout and try and get their bats rolling.
Absolutely. Wind is picking up here. I don't know if that's going to affect the pitchers very much. Got dust blowing in our face, to say the least.
Yes, honestly, I can taste it, and that's never a good thing. But it is funny. I really hadn't noticed it until this
year.
Got
the rundown we've been waiting on. Oh, knocked the ball out. And that's going to do it. That's going to be 15 runs.
And that makes sense why Alina at third base was so darn aggressive, and she was playing cat and mouse because she was the winning run, and as soon as that crossed the plate, that meant that the game was over. So a quick game today, but very good play by Winning Edge, and Debruler stayed in there pretty well. We saw some good things on both ends. So Abby Malko, Scott Sager with me here tonight. Thank you for helping me.
Thank you, Abby. I've enjoyed it. I hope everybody continues to tune in, RTC TV, for all the great sporting events we've got coming up.
You've been watching Rochester Youth Girls Softball on RTC TV. We'll see you next time. Welcome back to Rochester Youth Girls Softball.
Abby's eating some crow.
I know that we just said goodbye. Actually, in my defense, you're the one that said goodbye.
Okay, I did do the call out.
Thank you.
We were done. There were nobody on the field. In all honesty, folks, what's happened here is that there was a seven-run, is that correct, Abby?
Yes.
A seven-run rule at this level per inning. So the Debruler team does have a chance to rebuttal right here. We'll see what happens. Let's hope they can get those bats going as we're into action in the bottom of the third inning.
And this is Tessa up to bat. This will be her first at-bat of the game, and she will face the pitcher Alina and hope to get on base so that Debruler can get a rally going. Now, Debruler needs to score, I think, three runs here if they want to keep this game going. If not, then the run rule will have succeeded.
Gotcha. Now, talk to me, Abby. One of the things I'm seeing in youth league softball that wasn't there when my sister played years ago, and that is a lot of the protective gear.
Yes, that's a huge thing, especially as the game has gone on, and a very nice hit to shortstop. She will be out. Very good arm.
Really nice play there.
Very good arm by the shortstop. That's Ariana. She's had a great game so far. Always getting on, always stealing bases, and now she's a shortstop. And I've always, you know, been told, or you see other teams, that one of the best athletes on the field is usually at shortstop. So that's definitely true here. But back to your question about the protective gear. as the years have gone on, I was in travel ball a few summers back, and there was a girl actually to get hit in the head with a line drive. She was pitching. And so if you see Elena right now, she's got a face mask on, and usually they advise the corners and the pitcher to have a face mask on, because sometimes the ball gets hit so hard, you don't even see it. And I know I've seen it at the college level. They hit it so hard, and you don't even have human reaction time that's enough to get your glove up there. So that's always dangerous. And when you're up to bat, they like you to have a face mask on, because I've seen foul balls back in girls' faces. I know there was a girl from Baylor University who hit a foul ball up to her face and shattered her cheekbones. And there's just a lot of messy stuff that can happen when you've got a ball flying around. And, you know, the people on third base and first base, they're usually less than 60 feet away at most times. So that's a pretty close distance when a ball's coming this hard.
Absolutely. And as I could look at the corners right now, they're both playing inside the bag about 8 feet.
Yes. And speaking of injuries, and usually the second baseman and the shortstop, and pause for a second, that will be the second out of the inning, bringing Izzy up to the plate. Usually the second baseman and shortstop stay back because they've got some more reaction time. But my sister playing travel ball this weekend faced a team where the second baseman got hit by a bad hop. It was a ground ball, bad hop up to her face, and lost four of her teeth. So usually the middle infielders like to think that they're a little quicker and they've got, you know, a lot more reaction time. But if you've got a rock or a bad hop on a cruddy field, it's really hard to defend.
Nice swing there. Good hit down right side. That is defended. That's going to be it. The end of the game. Winning Edge takes down Debruler. Nice effort by everyone here tonight. Enjoyed watching the Winning Edge team as they defeat Debruler. Debruler, a little work to do. We saw some great things, though. We wish them both the best of luck this season as we go into the championship series next week. Abby, I want to thank you for being here.
Thank you, and I'm sorry I did not know the run rule. We were just testing the audience.
That's right, that's right. If anyone else has any rules they want to share, you're welcome to send those to abigail.malco@rtc1.com.
Please, I would like some emails more than the newsletters I get.
Absolutely. Well, thank you again for joining us. Continue to watch RTC TV this season as we continue to bring sports from around Rochester.